Okay, everyone, if you want to get seated, we'll get started. All right, what a great lunch session, wasn't that, with the posters and demos and networking? I'm glad we could all enjoy that together. So now we move towards the second part of our program. We're starting to think about engaging more here and working together. We are fortunate enough to have panelists and members of our MCBK planning committee that have been very instrumental in bringing us to where we are today. Jerry Perry and Nancy Ali are gonna share their thoughts on a panel we're entitling Engaging Critical Stakeholders. And I will give a brief introduction to each one of them. They'll each give their perspective from a library and community and publishing community and some of those aspects of mobilizing computable biomedical knowledge. And then we will definitely have time for questions and answers. And then after that, we're gonna move to the work group, charge to work group. So we'll get a little discussion and preview of the four different work groups before we break out and move into those breakout sessions. So first is my honor to introduce Jerry Perry, who is an associate dean for the University of Arizona Libraries and the director of the University of Arizona Health Sciences Library. As a director of that library, Mr. Perry provides leadership in the health system, which serves the University of Arizona Health Sciences campus, including the colleges of medicine, nursing, public health, and pharmacy. Jerry has over 30 years of experience as a health sciences librarian and has been active in the Medical Library Association and serving as president for a number of years. Mr. Perry serves on the board of directors for the Association of Academic Health Sciences Libraries, and he is the co-chair of the MCBK Sustainability and Inclusion Work Group. And we also have Nancy Ali, who is the interim director of the Taubman Health Sciences Library at the University of Michigan, and she's a faculty member of the Department of Learning Health Sciences at the University of Michigan. She provides library leadership for the health sciences and STEM libraries and works with the management team to plan, implement, and evaluate programs and services in the areas of academic and clinical engagement, research in informatics, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, and various collections and scholarly communication. Nancy Ali is also managing assistant editor for the Learning Health Systems Journal and is a member of the Academy of Health Information Professionals at the distinguished level. And she participates as a member of the MCBK Sustainability and Inclusion Work Group as well. So both Jerry and Nancy have agreed to join us today and share their perspectives of critical stakeholders in this curation and mobilization of CBK. So with that, I'll turn it over to Jerry.
Thank you so much, Rachel, and good afternoon, everyone. So as was mentioned, I'm Jerry Perry, and I'd like to talk with you a little bit about engaging critical stakeholders and emphasis on the word critical. You'll understand a little bit more as we advance. Slides, go forward. That's all right. Thank you so much. So just to center my presentation and my comments today with this group, I'll let you know, it was mentioned that I have about 35, not 30 years of experience as a medical librarian, and since 07 as a director or an associate dean with the organizations that I've worked. My background, my scholarship and research interests have been in the spanning boundaries between library and informatics work. I've also done a lot of work in diversity and inclusion, informatics, and around administration and management issues for libraries. My career began and was forged in the area of activism, originally around HIV/AIDS and community engagement in the research enterprise to find solutions to the HIV/AIDS pandemic. And then as time went and as my own work evolved and my engagement evolved over time, my expanded perspective broadened to include issues around equitable access to information. And now more recently, I've gotten involved in some social justice activism. So just a slide to give you a context of where I'm coming from. My involvement was largely around originally engaging in community activities that supported community-based participatory research and recognizing the role that communities who are impacted by disease have in terms of their self-determination and autonomy in the kind of research that's conducted about them and for them and by them. It's really about voice in that context. And this, I want to make a point just to reference something that we heard Patty Brennan mentioned a little bit earlier today around patients' rights to engagement. I think that that is an echo or a carry forward of some of the same similar concepts around autonomy and engagement with communities that are impacted by disease and carry that burden. So a little bit more around my biases. As was mentioned, you know where I'm coming from with the University of Arizona and my roles, but it's the mobilization or the mobilizing part of the MCBK that really is my passion and why I want to be here. And my interpretation of mobilizing is about getting the word out and engaging communities and generating excitement, passion, commitment, and as well, some of the things that go with that, including accountability. So myself, and one of the things that I'm trying to do in my work with the MCBK community is bring a commitment to engaging a broad spectrum of stakeholders into the conversation. You know, in this room, we have very deep literacy around the technical issues, around policy, around standards, and around metadata, and these other kinds of things. But there's also a need for deep literacy around human behavior, around how people respond and information as it's consumed and utilized, the way that we think about and interpret meaning to the work that we're doing. These are some of the broader things that I want to make sure that we don't lose sight of. And as probably you can tell from my own history, I'm happy to do some disruption, as it might be necessary if that helps us ensure equity. So thinking about CBK, I think about it as a force for good, obviously. But we also know that it can also be unintentionally or intentionally, in malfeasance, to perpetuate discrimination. And we've seen this potential when we look at what happens with algorithms. And it's been disclosed in the work of people like Sophia Noble at the USC Annenberg School, who wrote a book about the algorithms of oppression. It's a book that I really recommend folks focus on. It's an important addition to the corpus of knowledge about how we think about algorithms as we move into this technology-informed future. So, you know, we've talked a little bit about the notion of what CBK must be, and I'd just like to add, you know, hearkening back to my comment about the patient's rights of engagement, that CBK really also has to be accountable, of course, and fair, not just in the fair principles that we've talked about, but fair, equitable, I mean. It also needs to be transparent. And we can also think about this in the framework of health as a human right. How do we apply something like a human rights concept or component, or even something like civic duty when we start thinking about algorithmic applications of computable biomedical knowledge? So in terms of thinking about some of the critical stakeholders, our group, MCBK, over the last few years has thought about knowledge creators, and we've thought about knowledge curators, whether those librarians or others. We've thought about knowledge distributors and knowledge engineers. And we've also talked about technology developers and those folks who are in professional societies. And in fact, today, the Sustainability and Inclusion Workgroup that I co-chair with Chris Dimmick will be doing a deeper dive investigation into professional societies and clinical guidelines generators in terms of how we can effectively message and communicate with them. But my interest is extending this concept of what is a critical stakeholder beyond the framework of these individuals to think about the broader society and the broader culture in which we're operating. Because in my estimation, it's going to come down to people and culture in terms of really getting traction with the idea of CBK and its potential and uses, but also its ramifications in the broader culture and the broader society. So some of the other critical stakeholders I would suggest include patient advocacy groups, and I would suggest that we not underestimate them. I'm not suggesting that we have, but I think it's important to recognize the role of the end, ultimate end consumer in the work that we're doing. My own bias here or prejudice would be to work if we can, with patient advocacy consortia, because I think that there is some resonance there around governance issues about which we might want to be involved. I think we need to think about policymakers and how they view externally the work that's happening around computable biomedical knowledge. I call attention to a new thing that's emerged recently, just within the last few months. Some House of Representatives from the Democratic Party have put forward a potential law on algorithmic accountability, the Algorithmic Accountability Act, which is really, I think, a reflection of how community, how the broader public is looking at algorithms and looking at the potential social justice issues, the potential for bias and the potential for discrimination in this space, whether it pertains to security or whether it pertains to privacy, but as well just recognizing that there is a cultural perception around the black box that are algorithms that I think we need to be cognizant of and not lose sight. I would also purport that we need to pay attention to what happens in the social media context. There are thought leaders in this space that we might find very advantageous for us to work with as we think about how we might want to find popular traction with the concepts that we're talking about here today. There are also still journalists. Not everything has become a social media or individual self-journalists. We have people who are still credentialed to be journalists, writers who are in this space with expertise. I would suggest, because of the difficulty in crafting a well-honed and impactful message, that we ought to be thinking about how we engage with individuals who report on the progress in health and health sciences. I know Nancy's going to speak a little bit more about this next concept, but thinking about open access to information, the evolving and changing world of scholarly communications is very much involved now with an embrace of open and thinking about not only open science and open data, but also open frameworks for how this all gets achieved. And I know that Nancy will have some really cogent comments to make around all of this. And obviously, I'm steeped with many years of experience in the libraries world, but I would caution us not to focus too intently on just the academic or the health sciences library community, but to think also about other libraries that operate. Now, there's the sister libraries that we have as academic health sciences that are our general academic libraries, which are largely staffed and supported and resourced to provide services and materials that individual academic health sciences libraries do not have access to, unless you're operating in a networked environment like I am at the University of Arizona. An example of something like that are repositories and networks of deep repositories that can handle not just text, but other kinds of objects, including knowledge objects and code. I think it's going to be critical for us to work with our general academic partners in this space because of those resources that I think that we'll need to bring forward. But I'd just like to remind folks that, you know, for instance, the All of Us campaign has explicitly, through the National Networks of Libraries of Medicine, engaged the Public Library Network. And that's a really important connection because trust. Folks trust libraries. Folks trust public libraries and community. And those are really important values that I think we need not lose sight of. And because of where I come from, I want to make sure that we include some cultural components. Thinking about the constituencies with which we serve, I think we need to be mindful of who is in the space that we're working on and about whom we are thinking. Folks who attended a lecture that I gave at the Medical Library Association may recognize a few of these images, but I wanted to make sure to include them so that we're making sure that we're present with our cultural diversity in the space that we're talking about. So the sustainability and inclusion work group that I've been working on, and I'm sorry to give an additional plug to my group, but we've been really placing an emphasis on mobilizing our message through strategic communications. I think that it's really going to be important for us to find that balance between leading through communications, educating, and then engaging inclusively and recognizing voice as we work with individuals. I was trying to think of a way to sort of phrase this in my own mind to conceptualize the value proposition that our work in this space working around the communications challenge. What do we bring to the table? And I would suggest that an inclusive community that's committed to equity with rich and deep social networks and with messages that are rooted in values that are aimed at and are meaningful to critical communities will truly enhance the chances for our success in this space. I really believe that we can be seen as a community engaged in MCBK as an enabling and an expediting community that brings a critical eye, especially around things like accountability when it comes to a CBK. And perhaps this can be through mechanisms like transparent auditing standards that we might want to encourage and have applied. But it's the kind of thinking that I think that we need to do so that we're prepared for this future. I also believe, looking at who's all in this room and who has presented already today, that there's huge diversity and strength in that diversity in the room and in the space that I think is important for us to leverage. And I would also offer a comment around caution. I think that we have value in our independence, and I think that we should maintain that independence, recognizing that we work with a variety of stakeholders. But to hold ourselves as an independent pose, I think really gives us an additional strength and resource. Some more fun images just to remind us of community. So some notions that I wanted to surface for the group to sort of think about, and this isn't as much in when we think about modeling, when we were talking about modeling with humans and with people, as well as modeling relationships and remodeling the way that we want to work together as we move forward, thinking about us as community and thinking about that mobilization component. I'd just like us to recognize and remember who is and who isn't in the room when we're talking about next steps or the things that we want to achieve and accomplish. Thinking about whose backgrounds or experiences are being centered when we're talking about the work that we want to do. By centered, I mean the focus and the idea and attention. Whose experiences or background or perspectives are absent or not in the space. And then getting into the broader habit of asking if there's a diversity or equity component to the work that we're doing. Making that a kind of a habit, a little bit of a mantra, is not a bad thing. And these are not unique Jerry Perry ideas. These are inclusive excellence ideas that come from the groundwork in a multicultural community building. So these are things that I'm hoping we'll think about. And then I think it's always important for us to remember that if there is a social component to our work now or down the road, asking that question and wondering aloud and actively in an engaged way, what does it mean really for the ultimate consumer? A few other things that I'd like to add that I didn't really put onto this because it was something new to me as I was doing some deeper reading into governance issues around artificial intelligence, which is something that really interests me. And there's a terrific article that came out of the Philosophical Transactions A. It's something on AI governance by Corinne Kath out of the UK in the Turing Institute or Academy. But I would, there's a notion that she surfaces in a conversation as an oversight of an issue that talks around governance and AI, around avoiding technical solutionism, this notion that somehow there's going to be a technical solution to complex problems where there's a risk of tying complex social issues like equity or human rights or social justice and assuming or thinking that there might be a technical solution in these spaces that alone, that technology will override or somehow resolve what are in fact truly really complex human relations issues. I think we need to be mindful of all of that. I think the sustainability and inclusion groups, with its focus on inclusion on communications, is really an important conduit for us to focus on explainability and interpretability of the work that we're doing, and that we need to avoid a sort of throw up our hands sort of solution and just say that it's too technical when we're working with various constituencies, such as the ones that I've mentioned, to assume or to think that it's too technical to describe to a public library or a patient community, I think is a failure. And I think that may just mean that we haven't worked hard enough on our messaging, or perhaps the technology that we're trying to describe is poor. I think we should be open to recognizing that and to not steer away from the hard work of describing clearly the nature of what we're doing. And I think also it's really important to remember that a good best practice is always to involve multiple diverse stakeholders and to do that from the get-go. I think that that really positions us better for potential success. I think that's probably the end of my comments right now. I don't know if we want to do questions at this point or wait till Nancy has presented. If anybody has any questions immediately, we can, I look to Rachel. I have to stand on my tiptoes to see you, but any questions or any comments, thoughts, or perspectives that folks want to share at this point? Yikes, not one. Well, I'll be around, of course, and we'll have some time after Nancy's presentation. Oops, did I go too far? I think they're going to queue up Nancy next. Thank you. Well, thank you very much for your attention.
Good afternoon, everyone. First, I want to thank Chuck and Rachel for inviting me to present today, and also to say that I'm so happy to be working with my colleague, Jerry, and to be part of this session with him. I'm going to be talking about engaging critical stakeholders from the point of academic and public partnerships. And first, I just want to emphasize again that I am the Managing Assistant Editor of Learning Health Systems, the journal. I'll be talking a little bit about it, but want to make clear that I am not here to promote this as a service or product, but just to share information with you and get your input for some of the things that we're looking at. I'm also Collections Coordinator for Health Sciences and STEM Collections, so that means I manage a budget for collections resources, and I do license negotiation with publishers. I have a predisposed affinity for working collaboratively with all groups that I come into contact with, and so I think of publishers from a library's perspective, not as our enemy, but as our friends, and so try to work from that perspective. I'll be talking a little bit about open access, and from my work as a collections coordinator, I also have a keen understanding that open is not synonymous with free. And then as Rachel and Jerry mentioned, I am a member of the Sustainability and Inclusion Workgroup. So some of the things I'm going to be talking about and focusing about during this presentation are the perspective of academic and publisher partnerships, specifically looking at the partnership that the University of Michigan has with Wiley Publishing and producing the open access journal, Learning Health Systems. I'll be talking a little bit about some of the current scholarly communication trends driving changes in publishing, a lot around open access, open data, open research. We could have an entire conference focused on those topics, so I'll be referencing those, but there's a lot more to know and be engaged in on that topic. Looking at some of the implications of those trends as they apply to learning health systems and computable knowledge. And then I'm going to be introducing the journal's new format for accepting computable knowledge publication submissions. And here, I'm really looking for input and guidance from this community. So a little bit of background context in terms of the partnership with Wiley Publishing. And the University of Michigan. The University of Michigan is the owner of the journal Learning Health Systems, and we work then in collaboration with Wiley as the publisher. We began our contract in May 2015. It seems like yesterday, but it's really 4 years that has gone by really quickly. And then about 2.5 years later, we published our first issue, January 2017, volume one, issue one, and now we are on our current issue, volume three, issue three, that just came out. And so 2.5 years down the road, we're now looking at this model, this new manuscript type of computable knowledge publications. This partnership came about, I think, because from Wiley's perspective and Michigan's perspective, we needed access to a journal home, and Wiley was able to provide a solution. We were both interested in building community around learning health systems as an interdisciplinary, boundary-spanning area of research. We wanted, from the beginning, to foster and support open initiatives. So from the very beginning, the journal has been open access, online only. And we wanted now to be at the forefront of some of the new publishing formats that are emerging, and I'll talk more about that in a little while. So some of the changes in the scholarly communication and publishing landscape, and many of you may be familiar with these already. You may be part of organizations that are participating in these initiatives. But from a European perspective, Plan S and Coalition S, you'll see a lot in the literature about these. This initiative, it's a statement of intent from a group of national research funding organizations that has the support of the European Commission and the European Research Council for research that's been published and funded by public grants to be published in open access journals or on open access platforms. And that's similar to the NIH compliance initiative in terms of making publicly funded research available to the public. The University of California is engaged in negotiations with Elsevier. They were looking at a proposal for their new journal subscription that is a model that had a default publication option for UC authors to publish open access. They were looking for a cost-neutral option that would combine their traditional subscriptions and the author publishing fees for open access publication. University of California, I think, was able to enter into this kind of negotiation with Elsevier because they're in a sort of unique situation. It's a system-wide institutional effort. My understanding is they have a collections budget that's allocated centrally. And this effort is backed by their faculty, by their academic senate. And so that allowed them to take a stand for open access in ways that are different or might be different from other institutions. Then there's, as you'll read in the news, there are a lot of tensions, I think, around that negotiation with Elsevier. Many libraries, including Michigan, are watching closely what will be the outcome of those negotiations. The new initiative with Wiley, a little less tension intensive, involving the Project Deal. And this is a countrywide partnership agreement with over 700 institutions, including higher ed institutions in Germany, for researchers to be able to publish open access articles and also have read access to Wiley's full portfolio of journals so that they're not behind a paywall, that they would have access to those. And this initiative is backed by academic, funder, and publishing partners. And it's just coming into being here in July, so very timely. In addition to open access in terms of open data and open research, there are more groups enabling research data to be shared, used, reused, cited. These are just a few examples on a global scale: Research Data Alliance, World Data System, and CORUS. But the idea here is to increase transparency and reproducibility, to improve access to research, and to be able to guide government policies. There are more journals that are publishing software and models. Some of the journals that you can see these kinds of resources published in are Artificial Intelligence in Medicine, Computer Methods and Programs, and so on. And so we feel that there's the time and the opportunity now for learning health systems to be looking at publishing a new format that's going to involve computable knowledge publications. Entering into this arena will allow us to focus on what Chuck was talking about earlier today, about the data to knowledge and practice. So it's more than just publishing software, it's actually looking at publishing knowledge and the difference that that can make in terms of improving health and healthcare, improving access to research and reducing barriers. We want to introduce also a publication of and access to research that's relevant to the kind of work that MCBK is doing, including the work of all of the working groups on standards, technical infrastructure, policies that involve quality and trust and sustainability and inclusion, as Jerry spoke so eloquently about. And so again, we're seeking your input, advice, and guidance. And what I would like to talk about now are the author guidelines that we're looking at in terms of introducing this new publication type. So this is a pilot initiative beginning this month. We actually received our first publication of this type earlier this week. We're looking at engaging in this initiative in pilot mode so that we can learn from the experience and be able to apply that into the policies and procedures and the further guidelines that we'll develop. The procedures and review processes will initially, as part of the pilot, will be worked out in an interactive way between the journal and submitting authors. And then after the pilot, we'll be able to capture that information and adopt more permanent policies and procedures. So for the types of publications that we're looking at those that make biomedical models and algorithms available as peer-reviewed software. The peer-reviewed component is very important in terms of trust and quality assurance kinds of issues. There'll be, these types of publications will be comprised of two components. One or more software artifacts or digital knowledge objects, and an accompanying written human-readable manuscript that describes the knowledge objects. So you get the object and then the information about it, the descriptive information. For these two types of publications, we're looking at full-length computable knowledge enhanced publications. And for this type of publication, it would describe a previously unpublished scientific effort that results in a computable artifact and provides one or more knowledge objects. Another type could be a shorter computable knowledge implementation publication. And for this type of publication, it would serve as a bridge to implementation. So it would describe a technical deployment and implementation details and share a computable artifact. This type of publication, the CKIP acronym, this type of publication can complement other previously published or soon to be published articles, and it enables sharing of peer-reviewed computable artifacts that have not previously been available in any systematic way and their implementation in practice. For both of these publication types, the paper would be available as a PDF from the Learning Health System website, and then there would be an embedded link within that article to enable downloading of the computable knowledge objects. In terms of structure and scope for the knowledge objects, these would be representation of models that could have resulted from analytical machine learning or deliberative process. The models need to be relevant within a health or healthcare environment, so they have to be able to relate to individual or population health, including clinical, educational, research, or public health domains. And I know from the show of hands earlier at the beginning of the day, there are a lot of you in the audience who are interested in these particular areas. There would be three primary components the payload, which would be the executable code that would implement the model, and service specifications, a representation of the data required by the model and the result that the model generates, as well as metadata, so specified sets of fields describing the model. I was having a conversation with someone earlier today, and they were asking whether data dictionaries should be included for this type of publication, and I think that would be very important. So some of the examples of this publication type could be anything from regression models to guidelines, workflows, policies, and so on. The submission requirements, what we're asking is an initial proposal that would come to the editorial team for the journal describing what the plan is, and then also an executable file that would contain the knowledge object source code and any information that was needed to be able to run that. There would be a coded file that would have test data. This is going to be important in terms of the review process because that test data would be used to test the source code along with all of the details describing the input data for the model and the output that would be generated. Again, the metadata is needed to be able to characterize the knowledge object, and that, including the metadata, will inform development of a standard metadata set for a learning health system, so it will be useful to other potential authors. The requirements also include having the software license available that would allow testers and readers to access and run the source code using the test data that would be submitted. For quality assurance and trust, this is very important. And so the manuscript submissions should include a technical implementation and the test plan. And the authors, prior to publication of the computable knowledge paper, would have to affirm that any errors or inaccuracies, malfunctions in the coded knowledge objects are their sole responsibility, and that there's not anything included in the software that the use of which would violate the software license. Also, again, another very important requirement, the knowledge objects and test data cannot contain any protected health information. The review process, again, this is part of ensuring trust and quality. The papers will be evaluated by at least two external reviewers, and their review process will use the criteria that closely parallels that is used for research papers. The knowledge objects will be separately evaluated by the editorial office. The payloads will be tested as part of the use of the review process. The output data will be compared to what has been said that would be the outcome. The test report will be provided to submitting authors, and if there isn't reproducibility, then the submission will not be able to be accepted until the knowledge objects can be revised and successfully retested. So, as I was mentioning earlier, Learning Health Systems is an open access journal. So for authors who would be submitting this type of publication, they retain copyright of their work, the full intellectual property rights. So this covers not only the typical publications that the journal publishes, but also applies to everything involving the computable knowledge publications and the related knowledge objects. LHS is now indexed in PubMed Central, Scopus, ESCII, the Emerging Sources Citation Index, and the ACM Digital Library. And so now I would like to invite you to ask any questions that you might have, to give us any input and advice that you might want to share about our process and procedures. And then I have in conversation with Jerry, we developed some questions that we thought might be of interest for this audience to discuss. So let me first take questions that you have about my presentation, and then we'll open it up to other types of discussion questions.
Hi, thank you. Preston Lee with VA. I authored the HL7 marketplace specification, which has some similar aims, but has just kind of a different perspective on how, you know, perhaps to achieve it. And there are just a couple comments that I wanted to make. First of all, when I saw the announcement, I was very excited. There's a couple statements that I noticed were in your slides that I think I need to be revised. One of those is that there will be a requirement to attest that there's no embedded intellectual property. And for software, that is categorically implausible to do. I mean, you can ask people to answer that truthfully, but I mean, in truth, that just doesn't happen in the real world for software. And I'm not quite sure how what the rationale is for having that there, but real world software projects depend on open source things, open source runtimes, closed source runtimes and products sometimes that do have a lot of nested intellectual property problems that go with them. And my second comment also is along those lines, and that from real-world feedback on some of the real-world implications is that, you know, the idea of, as a, you know, for VA and other providers, it'd be great if all CBK was open and free in all possible senses of the word, you know, but the reality is, you know, we have to acquire things that are commercial and less than open and less than free, and it would be fantastic if we could leverage the same types of processes that, you know, the academia is very comfortable with, but also, you know, include a more diverse array of licensing schemes that the commercial space could also use. You know, so we could have a shared trust model, but that also allows for commercial use and adoption of the platform.
Okay, thank you very much for your candid comments. This was exactly the kind of feedback that we were hoping to receive. And I want to say, in terms of the embedded software, that element, our process, policy, guidelines, procedures here have been vetted through several audiences, including with our general counsel's office at the University of Michigan. And so that component was added after a conversation with the general counsel's office. So I'm going to take your feedback to the editorial team, and we'll see what we can do.
Let me expand that, and I'm happy to go into the deal, because I can just rattle off use cases all day. Terminology is also, the license around terminology is so broken that all of us, most people in this room are breaking the UMLS license, like possibly right now. Yes. if you've read it, and there are redistribution clauses and a lot of gotchas in the SNOMED license and the LOINC license and so on that I think need a lot more depth than that bullet point.
Yes.
I'll shut up now. Thank
you for your comments. And I just want to say that I took our general counsel, he teaches in the law school as well, as being general counsel for the university, and I took his higher ed law class, and I think he told our class that he reads every word of every license agreement. I think he may be the only person that I've ever encountered who admits to that, who says that. So, yes.
Hi, my name is Josh Richardson. I'm with RTI. I'm really excited about this approach. I think this opens up a world of opportunities by having this this new publication model. I guess I have one question for you and maybe one observation feedback. And so first off is, as an informatician who's primarily used qualitative methods, has there been any thought or discussions around what knowledge objects would look like for qualitative work in ways that any kind of qualitative data or analytical models that would be used in the qualitative space could be incorporated? And then kind of a reaction or observation is that, one thing that has me thinking is that if, like, for example, there are forms of publication in which you can't offer a knowledge object, are some types of authors being given more publication opportunities than others? And I wonder what impact that might have on how teams are put together, how research is designed. Say, for example, we need to have a knowledge object so we get that second opportunity, whereas we only get one. And also for the academia space, or academic space, sorry, would that mean that there are some faculty who would have more, again, publication options than others? And I'm just, you know, beginning to just think, like, wondering, like, what that would mean for a department or departments and faculty, you know, politics and all that good stuff. I don't know, that's one thing that I've been kind of just thinking about as you present. Thanks.
Thank you. So an excellent question in terms of the qualitative piece and what knowledge objects are resulting from qualitative research might be. And with that question, we'll go back and look at the kinds of examples that we're providing. So I really appreciate that question. And then what impact might this have on the work of teams, and how might it drive a need to produce a knowledge object is something that I think we'll have to give some more thought to. So I don't have a ready-made answer for that, but it's a really interesting question in terms of what drives research. So.
I'm Steve Hazley from the American College of OBGYN. This is really a fascinating concept. And in my concept of a research study, not only is there a method, which is the knowledge artifact here, I think, but there's a result. You did this thing, and here my N was 1,000, and 600 people did this, and 400 people did that. And then you publish it, and a year later, someone else uses a similar methodology, and their N's 2,000, and they said, well, I got this, and I got that. And then 5 years later, somebody does a meta-analysis and smushes them all together, and that's better evidence, right? Can you short-circuit that with this approach? I have a knowledge artifact. I share the artifact. 20 institutions plug it into their system. Are you making a plan to accumulate their accumulated data so my original study that had an N of 1,000 now has an N of 100,000 because, and how can we put that into your paradigm?
Another great question, and I was going to say that as the journal Learning Health Systems, we would look forward to all of those submissions, but it does raise an interesting question in terms of growth and other examples of how the research results have been applied and how you connect those. And what I'm thinking right now is just as an image from Patty Brennan's talk, if you were here earlier, that sphere of knowledge and the connectivity. And there has to be, I think we need to give some more thought to how we make those kinds of connections to other work that's resulting from this. And so, again, I'm going to take that question back to the editorial team and think how we can think in terms of that sphere of knowledge and the connectivity from the results of all of the research in this space.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hi.
Isaac Robinson, undergrad from Yale. I'm wondering how this idea of a knowledge object compares to the standard in artificial intelligence publishing right now to publish your code open source on GitHub.
I'm sorry, I'm not hearing the part that you just said.
Sorry. There's a standard right now in artificial intelligence research to publish all of your code open source on GitHub. How does that practice compare to this idea of a knowledge object?
So I think from my perspective, and then I'm going to invite comment from others in the room, I think that GitHub might not be the sole solution. And so looking at, for example, coming from University of Michigan, we have a digital repository, we have a data repository, our publisher has a data repository, and so I think there will probably be multiple kinds of solutions and not just one ultimate repository for this kind of research. Let me see if anybody else wants to comment on that.
Okay. Yeah, directly to that. I think we need to be very careful about GitHub because it's not truly a repository. It's not curated. It's kind of like when my cat brings me a bird and she's so proud of it and you don't know what to do with it, right? People put stuff out there. And I actually think that gets into what Jerry was talking, I mean, part of what you were talking about is the trust of what you're working with. So I think that's part of what, I don't think, I'm part of the steering committee and whatnot, that we're here to talk about. How do we build into the trust what we're designing? How do we think about more closely what do these knowledge objects mean and how do we disseminate them and trust what we're doing through the entire process?
Thank you. I invited Nancy to sit down and have a more general discussion on that topic, which is engaging critical stakeholders. So any additional questions, let's direct to both Jerry and Nancy.
So to these points, putting an MCBK framework on this, I think the deep question here is what does publication add? And I think the point about putting your code in GitHub versus putting a refereed publication in the archival literature that has a knowledge object embedded in it, that difference is the difference that I think we're going to here. And I think this is an experiment. I think we're trying to understand what that difference is and what publication adds to what could otherwise be a free and open availability of models of all sorts of varying levels of maturity tested in different ways or maybe not tested at all out there. And I don't know the answer to that question, but I think what's exciting about this, at least for me, as it relates to MCBK, is that we'll come to understand what the value of publication, curation, indexing, metadata, what that value is for computable knowledge. The jury's out. I happen to think the value will be significant. But I'm interested in what others think.
Thanks very much, Deborah McGinnis from RPI. I love the notion of this journal, and I think it is a place that we should be going. I'm thoughtful about the level of effort. We had a conversation before this panel, too. I'm thoughtful about the level of effort that it takes to really check it. And I'm wondering if it's sustainable. So if we can keep it sustainable, I think we should go for it. But I'm wondering if there's also levels down that don't take as much checking. So I look at the International Semantic Web resource track that doesn't have the level of checking that you're doing. But you have to put the resource up. You have to put it someplace, typically in GitHub. You have to make a website, you have to have all of these things checked off, and then it is peer-reviewed, like a conference peer-reviews it. You know, is that good enough? It's not going to go to the level of, somebody made a comment earlier about enabling faster review processes. It's not going to kind of get to that quality standard, but I'm thinking we probably want to explore this spectrum. And I'm all about the metadata and all about the computer ingestibility of that data and the computer validation of that data. So maybe that's part of food for comment.
Yes.
I think your mic's not on. I don't think it's on.
Are there alternative models? And I think, again, another great question for us to explore during the pilot period. Alan.
Thanks, Nancy. We both work at the University of Michigan. Alan Flynn at Michigan. So question, Jerry. I was thinking about the kind of questions that I think you referred to as inclusivity questions along those lines that you put up on the slide there. It got me thinking about social systems and the way in social systems we find discretion. We find that one person can offer that to another person. The health system, I think, certainly is an example of that, but it's not just the health system, education system, the way people interact with libraries. There's discretion involved. We uphold people's privacy. So one of the concerns that I've had for a long time, both personally and professionally in the CBK space, is that machines, when we build models, force us to make things explicit. And yet, a lot of the kind of communication and the way that we maintain discretion is through implicit kinds of ways of handling information. And so I'm wondering if there's another question we should be asking when we model something or when we put a data model in the world, which is, to what degree are we making explicit something where we're all conditioned to think of that in an implicit way? It's more than just encryption will protect the data. What I'm actually referring to is more than that. It's about there are some times when we let something lie behind the scenes instead of putting it in the spotlight. We keep it, right? Although it's recognized, we keep it there because we want to protect people. So I'm just wondering if we should be adding another question to your list, which is, as we do this work, to what degree are we exposing things that wouldn't otherwise be exposed?
So I think that's a really great comment, and it's an important thing for us to track. And I was reminded as I was listening to the education use case that we heard earlier today about controversies that we're experiencing on our campus around learning analytics. And so what happens when individuals are disclosed to various parties, for instance, whether it's your advisor or your parents, there's lots of really tricky questions to be considered in that space. We had an example of a study that was conducted by a faculty member in artificial intelligence in our business college who was able to put together pieces of data that identified the behaviors of students off campus, including what their social networks were and the kinds of things that they were doing. This is a lot of disclosure, right, of information we would normally not pay any attention to. Thinking about the use case, you know, earlier, there was a lot of information that's potentially disclosive about that resident in their experience, and it can vary and can cross a range of different kinds of disclosures. It could be financial disclosures about working with that particular person as a practitioner. It could be information that could compromise that individual's sense of autonomy, voice, or just justice. So I think these are really critical things, and I thank you very much, Alan, for mentioning that.
If we could be very brief on the next two questions, and then we'll...
Okay, I'll try and be brief. What would you say to a group of people who are very practical, involved in starting to think about this from a health system point of view, where they would raise their eyes from saying, yes, but GitHub can do this? What two things would you say to them to say, there is a wider thing out there? I love the cat question, but some more practical things. Why like this? I was in a meeting and I was really struggling to find this. Help me.
Jerry and I are debating who should respond to that question. I'm trying to think what I would say if someone said that. For me, it's you know, from my perspective, looking at many options. Monopoly, you know, is kind of has a negative connotation to it, and I would think in terms of not having a monopoly in this space, and that there's value in doing a comparative analysis. So coming from a library perspective, when we are evaluating various products, we do that kind of comparative analysis. And so I would talk about the value of comparative analysis. So you're not excluding something, but you have criteria that are important to you and you use that lens to look at various products. And then sometimes, GitHub might be the logical solution, but there might be other products, other resources that offer more of the features and more of the value you need for a specific case that you're working with, project.
So I'll be very quick, and my question doesn't really need an answer. It's more of a thought provoker. It's the review process that you described for the Learning Health System Journal was pretty onerous on both the submitters, the reviewers, the editors. When you think about the fact that software isn't a static thing in the same way that a PDF of an article is, you start to think about how do we make a scalable, sustainable way for people to evaluate the quality of software, not just validating that one particular data set flows through it and comes out the way it's described in the article, but are there ways that we can use open peer review and other mechanisms to make it easier for the second paper, the third paper, the fourth paper, so that they don't have to reinvent that whole wheel all over again every single time, all the licensing, all the descriptive, all the metadata, and so that you can trust the current version when you read the article from four versions ago.
So thanks, Chris. Something that we'll need to consider during the pilot period, and it probably will be a matter of trying to balance a rigorous peer review process and the commitment to quality assurance and trust with the other circumstances that you're talking about in terms of convenience and being able to move something more quickly.
Great. Well, thank you so much, both of you, for wonderful presentations and thoughtful discussions. So the next, now we move to the fun part of the program, and I think this is just seamlessly ties into it, because in all these discussions, I see points of activity across our four work groups. So I'll invite a representative from each of the four work groups to start coming on stage, and we're going to key up the next set of slides. There'll be just one quick slide. I believe everyone has one. If not, they'll verbally spend a moment talking about their work group and the activities that they're proposing for this afternoon. And so we'll just have a quick overview of the work groups. As I mentioned before, we will publish notes and summaries and things of this meeting, so pick one work group that most interests you and try and stick with it both days, because I think we'll see our conversations evolving. And then after this overview, that'd be great, we could do this right here on the panel. After the overview of work groups, then we'll have a break, and then we'll have 90 minutes of working group time, and then we will come back for open mic, and we will have a chance to reflect and share comments. So we're pulling up the slides, so I don't know the order just yet, but and wherever we're comfortable, this can be. There's microphones here or there, so. I'm pretty sure you have a slide, right? So I know sustainability and mobilization, so they're pulling it up. Oh, it's not open. Maybe we're not seeing who's on site. If not, we'll move on. I'm trying to see these lists. I'm not seeing anything that says work group. Are we? Okay, so they're probably confused. So I know you had provided. Okay, do you want to see? Sure, you have a slide.
No, I don't.
Stakeholders? No, that's JPA. I'm not sure the use case. Is there a. Someone's driving this. All right, I don't see Lisa. Okay, so we're going to move on and invite someone who's not dependent on their slide to share a few moments. So you're not sure you have
sure.
One, so
yeah.
You start.
We didn't even realize we had a slide, so we'll go without it. So I'm Chris Schaefer, and this is?
Leslie McIntosh.
And we're with the Technical Infrastructure Group. We're interested in a whole variety of things, including the difference between pragmatic, practical infrastructure and conceptual infrastructure, issues around how do we design infrastructure so that it doesn't perpetuate bias. There's all sorts of examples in the machine learning world, for example, of bias being perpetuated by the way infrastructure is designed. We're also interested in questions about what we can do to influence, we as a community, the people in this room and the people that we recruit into this movement, can do to influence the people who are building infrastructure, because we're very cognizant that many of those people aren't here, aren't in the conversation yet. What should we be doing to reach out to them? And then how does all of this tie into the other groups that we have, the policy and trust, the standards? There's a lot of overlap between standards and infrastructure, and we're really focusing on how we can support those groups by doing things that will encourage developers to behave in ways that lead towards more sharing and openness and transparency and all of the other things that we've been doing around computable biomedical knowledge artifacts.
And in a practical standpoint, today what we're going to do for is get together where you have four questions after we give a short overview about infrastructure to try to crowdsource from this crowd the answers to the questions. Tomorrow we're going to have a few presentations from people who also have posters up, and then we're going to come back to our discussion and come up with the answers to our questions to present, you know, the conceptualization of a technical infrastructure, how we build in trust, how we think about these challenges from a very granular level to a more societal level.
So you've already seen Jerry in the last session, and he did a terrific job talking somewhat about what our sustainability and inclusion work group is all about. But what we'd like to share with you right now is what we're specifically going to work on today. So just a quick reminder, as you can see on the slide here, our work group is charged with mobilizing diverse stakeholders and active engagement around the value proposition of computable biomedical knowledge. So during our breakout, we're focused on creating tactical plans for outreach to professional societies. And today we're very pleased to have with us representatives from ACOG, which is the American College of Obstetrics and Obstetricians and Gynecologists, sorry, friends, and the American Medical Informatics Association, AMIA. And we're going to be chatting with them about what kinds of messages would resonate with folks who are members in their organizations. How do we best reach out to their organizations? And we'd like the folks in our work group to actually take that information in and help us not only additionally question our ACOG and AMIA friends, but also think about how can we, the MCBK community, best reach out to those groups given the information that we heard.
And then tomorrow we have a session which is similarly formatted, but instead we'll be focusing on some associations that include the AASL, the Association of Academic Health Sciences Libraries, and full disclosure, I'm on their board, so I can speak to some of their interests, and then also the Healthcare Information and Management System Society, or HIMSS. So we'll have an opportunity, and we have organized ourselves around a structured interview. Although I don't want that word structured to scare anyone away from our group, it is an open conversation, but we do have some questions that we want to make sure that we express. And we've developed a kind of communications template that we're going to try to populate. Our goal really was to come forward with a tangible object from which we can work in terms of advancing our efforts. I think that's about it.
So we'll either have policy or, there we go, technical infrastructure, we did, okay. And trust and policy, Jody, do you want to give a summary, and then we'll do standards.
Good afternoon. I co-chair this working group with Blackford Middleton, who chose to sit, and with a number of other really, we have a great dynamic group of people who are all contributing a lot to this group. And what we're really talking about is policy and trust and governance, and even we've been spending most of this year or a lot of this year trying to understand what it is that we're trying to create and talk and. Create policy for, what is the landscape that may have gaps or needs in the policy world or trustworthy or trust world, what is the ecosystem that we're operating in. So we'll sort of go over some of that work and hopefully continue to discuss it. I don't think we've resolved anything, but we're having some really great conversations focusing on sort of cases of groups, of organizations that have created platforms, environments, opportunities for computable biomedical knowledge to be generated and shared either within in any sort of context. So today we'll be going over some of that old work. We'll hopefully hear a little bit from CancerLink as an example of one of these platforms and begin to talk about emerging principles from this work. Examples of those things and some of those implications. Both today and tomorrow, I expect that we'll raise a lot of questions, and so we're hoping we can just document all of those questions so we know how to, we know where to spend our time moving forward. Tomorrow, we'll continue to brainstorm these ideas and to begin identifying industry needs related to trust and policy, governance issues, and some emerging sort of typology for MCBK in terms of whether that's IP, legal liability, business, economic needs, those kinds of issues. And we'll hear tomorrow from John Fox about Open Clinical as another example of a knowledge commons that's in operation right now and sort of working with operationalizing principles in the real world. So we look forward to working with you and we hope to see you in a couple minutes. Thank you.
Bruce wants to come up also. So Bruce Bray is my co-conspirator. Also, unofficial co-conspirator is Alan Flynn in the audience. We also have a very active work group, and there's a number of people that have contributed. And we're, as it says here, we're charged with developing and expanding on use cases that exemplify the needs for CBK in a number of different spheres. We've heard four of them this morning, and we have use cases that we've been developing in this work group on clinical and research foci that are a little different, but have some of the same characteristics as you heard about this morning in the panel. What we're going to do is elaborate a little bit briefly to get people that haven't been familiar and want to come to this session about the two use cases. One is a chronic disease patient in an urban setting moving across venues of care. And the second one is in the research domain of genomic, basically, and pathway analysis supporting evidence for therapeutics and then translation of that into the clinical decision-making domain. The way we're approaching this is to kind of develop a typology or a set of dimensions and axes describing knowledge artifacts, their uses, their settings, the ways that they're needed, kind of to address the FAIR principles, both for curation of knowledge and possibly ultimately for dynamic selection of knowledge resources at point of use. Another slide. It looks like they broke mine out or shortened it. Somebody did that. Because we had more on it. But what we are going to try to do is, and what kind of got exemplified by some further discussions today, is it seems that the level at which standards need to get addressed is different in the clinical domain in particular from some of the other domains we've heard about. I'm struck by the fact that there are many players, and one of the things we had on the slide that I originally had up here was that there are a lot of players in the clinical space that are working on standards, interoperability, and a variety of other efforts related to sharing of knowledge that MCBK would need to articulate with and to develop its kind of value proposition, and that's where we were initially saying this typology is important. But as I was hearing about the data-driven, like population health or public health, and also in the research domain, a lot of that seems to be in a space where there aren't a lot of existing standards bodies already staking out parts of the work, and it might be that what this group needs to do is actually develop more direct standards for some of those areas. So that's just a thought that came from our discussion this morning. But please come to our session, which is, are you going to announce the rooms?
We're going to put the rooms up in a bit. So if someone can put up the room slide, thank you. So thanks to all our work group co-chairs who put a lot of time and effort into sort of focusing these groups and identifying some discussion points for today. So.